your love and your grace and your mercy and your protection and your provision in our lives. We ask now that your Spirit would have his way in our hearts, that you would be our teacher, that you would touch us and encourage us, challenge us, convict us, mold and shape us to be the people that you want us to be. We thank you once again for your word, its clarity, its power, its majesty, what it reflects, gives us your truth. Use it in our lives today, we pray in Jesus' name. There have been times in recent years when it seems in our country God has withdrawn his hand from us. If we're honest, we would have to say we deserve it. Since 1963, when we removed prayer from public schools, and then in 1967, when public Bible reading was no longer allowed in schools, it seems that America, which was founded upon biblical principles, has been quickly sliding down the slippery slope of unbelief. Now, we have never been a perfect nation, but overall, the country was developed as a country that sought to worship God and walk according to his word. It is so amazing to reflect upon our history, and you can see God's hand in our history in so many different ways. We were raised up to be a city set on a hill, to be a light to the world of the gospel. But things seem to move rapidly away from God's word in recent years. I believe we have made improvements concerning the poor and even race relations, though it really doesn't seem like it in recent days. But part of our struggle, or a majority of our struggle, is that we have jettisoned what God declares concerning sin. Many in our culture no longer look to God's word to understand what is right or wrong, especially in the areas of sexuality and marriage and life. In April of 2016, Ann Graham Lotz wrote, "God warns a nation that judgment is coming. He doesn't want any to perish, but if a nation does not heed his warnings, he unleashes his anger, and there is nothing, no one, who can prevent it. If God would judge his own beloved nation of Judah, why would we think America could escape? So, if we are coming under the judgment of God, if he is giving us over to ourselves, removing his blessing, protection, and favor, the solution will not be found in politics, or the economy, or the military, or technology. The solution will be found on our knees as we humble ourselves, pray, seek God's face, and repent of our sin. Then plead for him to return to us as we return to him." As we approach Psalm 44 today, we find that the author feels as if God has forgotten their nation. Sometimes it feels like that to us. Though the people of Israel were once blessed by God as his people, the author feels now abandoned by God. But many believe the sons of Korah penned this psalm for their king and nation, cry out to God in times of adversity. This psalm reflects upon a time but a very serious military setback, and a people were greatly disturbed. So it was a time of calamity in the nation. We are not sure exactly the circumstances, but it was certainly a negative time in the land. Throughout this psalm, we hear the cry of doubt and struggle and fear and despair and defeat. It's a tough time. The author goes back and forth using we and I, speaking of his own concerns, speaking as if he is the king, speaking of the collective we or I for the people. It is a heartfelt prayer for the nation of Israel. They share throughout the psalm that they feel like they've been faithful to God. And so they question, why has he brought affliction upon them? They're asking, how could this be fair? But I don't believe the nation we can make that same argument that we've been faithful to God. There certainly is a remnant still in the United States. I hope we are a part of that remnant here. But in many ways, as a nation, we have abandoned the Christian principles upon which our nation was founded. No longer do we call certain sins sin. We tolerate what God does not and will not tolerate. No longer do we submit to God as the judge who holds our souls accountable. We want to see Him as a loving God, but not as a just and holy God. Many in our country have cast aside the truth of God and His Word altogether, to some God is only archaic and irrelevant in our day. They believe that mankind knows best. But we in His church, what we see in the psalmist today, we in His church must continue to trust the Lord, no matter what our nation believes, and no matter what we face as people. We must choose this day to trust the Lord no matter what. We have to make that choice. We must choose to remember and believe this day the words of Jesus who said to us, in this world you have tribulation. It's not going to be easy, but then He reminded us, I have overcome the world. We can ask our brothers and sisters in the presence of North Korea, or those who've gone through the famine of the Sudan or the refugee camps in Europe, can we still trust God though our circumstances are not good around us? And they are wonderful witnesses to us that it doesn't matter what's going on in our lives, in our world, we will trust God because He is our hope. Is that our hope today? We are here to say to the psalmist that our faith must not be based upon our circumstances, but upon the truth of God and His Word. Because our circumstances are going to go up and down. There will be times when things are going well in our lives, and other times, not so much. It's kind of like me playing golf. I mean, sometimes I just feel the blessing of God on my life. Wow, how did that happen? I had a birdie last week. Woo! That was a big deal for me. That means you did better than you're supposed to, by the way. For those who don't know. But then I go out and play the next day, and it's like, whoa, I don't know how to do this at all. So the question for us is, in the midst of our circumstances, whatever they are, are we still able to give them praise? Do we still have peace? and they enter joy in our lives. And so from Psalm 44 this morning, we see that we must trust God as we face uncertainty. Whatever we face in this life, we see we must remember what God has done in the past. Your remembrance of the past is so important throughout the scriptures. If God put in the calendar of the Israelite people festivals so that they would remember what He had done, He didn't want them to forget the Passover, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, several other festivals concerning the harvest, the Feast of Booths. God's provision in their history, times of thanksgiving for their nation, because they needed to remember the past and how God had worked. Here in verses 1 to 3, the psalmist reflects upon God's works in the days of old, how He drove out their enemies from the promised land at the time of Moses, and then specifically Joshua. And though the nation didn't always obey as they were supposed to, God put His favor upon His people. But it's so good for us to remember that God has worked throughout our nation. Sometimes it's easy to forget. But for much of our history, as a corporate people, as a nation, we have been a Christian nation. We have been a people trying to follow God's will according to His Word. Now again, we have not always done that perfectly. But the Pilgrims and the Puritans came to be a city on a hill, shining the light of the gospel to the world. That was their purpose. They came to worship God freely as a Christian nation. When they came over on the Mayflower, they came to worship God and start a nation that would honor Him and be a light to the world. William Bradford penned the Mayflower Agreement in 1620, signed by approximately 41 male passengers who came to the New World looking for freedom. Here's a portion of this Mayflower Agreement, what they would later call the Mayflower Compact. It says, having undertaken for the glory of God an advancement of the Christian faith. Wow! That's a pretty good start to a document. For the glory of God and the advancement so people would come to faith in Christ. In honor of our king and country of which to plant the first colony in the northern parts of Virginia, do by these presents solemnly and mutually in the presence of God and one another covenant and combine ourselves together in a civil body politic for our better ordering and preservation and furtherance of the ends aforesaid. In other words, for the purpose of the glory of God and to spread the kingdom of God. By virtue hereof, to enact, constitute, frame such just and equal laws, ordinances, acts, constitutions, and offices from time to time as to be thought by most meet and convenient for the general good of the colony unto which we promise all due submission and obedience. That's why the people came. To give glory to God and to spread the Christian faith. Don't ever forget that. People will try to rewrite history, don't they? During the desperate time of the Civil War, the Senate called on President Lincoln to declare a day of fasting and prayer. President Lincoln signed the proclamation into law on March 30th, 1863, right in the middle of the Civil War. Our nation was called to pray. The proclamation says this: whereas the Senate of the United States, devoutly recognizing the supreme authority and just government of Almighty God, what? They're bowing their knee to the supreme authority. In all the affairs of men, a nation tasked by a resolution requested the president to designate and set apart a day for national prayer and humiliation. And whereas it is the duty of nations as well as of men to own their dependence upon the overruling power of God, to confess their sins and transgressions in humble sorrow, yet with assured hope that genuine repentance will lead to mercy and pardon, and to recognize that the sublime truth announced in the Holy Scriptures, and proven by all history, that those nations only are blessed whose God is the Lord. That those nations only are blessed whose God is the Lord. That's our heritage. That's our history. There's so much in our history which says we are a nation that depends on God's grace, and we have seen His grace and His favor throughout our history. He has had His hand upon us. That's how we're still a nation today. That's how we got started in the first place. He led us. He protected us. He provided for us. He has had His hand upon us to bring about His purposes and spread the gospel to all the world through this nation. We must never forget that. His protection, His power, His provision in our history is so important. It's many in our country don't want to acknowledge God anymore or His word, which is the truth. What about in your own life? All of us can stand and share today how we have seen God work in the past. Don't forget that. How He is providing for us in a variety of ways, and especially if we have put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ as our Savior. We can give testimony of His love and how He's changed our lives. Don't ever forget that. It is important for us as a people to remember what He's done, to celebrate, and to give thanks for His goodness to us. Whatever we face in this life, we must remember what God has done in His past. And it is well, whatever we face in this life, we must remain faithful to God in the future. We must remain faithful to God. God has never promised us constant prosperity and victory in life. There are certainly times when we sense God's blessing and favor. We sense that He gives us abundance and prosperity in some way for His purposes. He does that. Certainly the nation of Israel experienced that throughout their history, because God was using them to proclaim His glory to all the other nations. He put His hand upon them. In verses 4 through 8, the psalmist boasts in God and how He has worked and delivered them in the past. But after this section, the psalmist and the nation now feels abandoned by God. He says in verses 11 and 12, "You give us as sheep to be eaten, and have scattered us among the nations. You sell your people cheaply, and have not profited by their sale." He continues, verses 14 and 15, "You make us a byword among the nations, a laughingstock among the people. All day long my dishonor is before me, and my humiliation has overwhelmed me." You see, now he is not, and the nation is not experiencing or feeling the blessing of God. He said, "I feel dishonored, I am ashamed, embarrassed. Master blesses them. The psalmist says he is committed to follow God. Verses 17 and 18, he says, all this has come upon us, but we have not forgotten you. And we have not dealt falsely with your covenant. Our heart has not turned back, and our steps have not deviated from your way. In many ways, this is a psalm like Job wrote about. When Job felt like God had withdrawn his hand and he didn't understand, but he tried to trust God no matter what. The author cries out in verses 20 to 22, if we have forgotten the name of our God or extended our hands to a strange God, would not God find this out? For he knows the secrets of the heart, but for your sake we are killed all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. That's how they felt. Abandoned by God. But they didn't make a change. There are certainly times in our own lives, in the history of our nation, when we don't understand what God is up to. We can certainly ask historically, why did God allow the Civil War when so many hundreds of thousands of people died? When the issue of slavery continues to bring strife and hurt and pain in our country to this very day, why does God allow them? Why did he allow millions of Jews to die in gas chambers? His own people. We could ask him, why does he allow any sickness? Why does he allow any famine, any hardship? We don't understand. We don't understand why a child is going through sickness or a family member suffers with divorce. The hurt and pain of life is tough. We can ask for our nation today, when God has blessed us so much in the past, why are we struggling so much right now in our history? Really, the bottom line, as much as we can understand, I believe, is this. That we struggle in life because of sin. Because of sin. God gave Adam and Eve a choice. He gave them a choice to follow him or to sin. But after a while, they chose sin, and it brought great hardship, pain, and suffering to the world. As best as I can understand, he gives each of us that same choice. Whether or not we're going to follow him or whether we're going to continue in our sin. We can choose to follow him in his ways, or we can choose to follow our own wisdom and try it out on our own for a while to think we know best, or follow after the world. You see, without this choice, we would only be robots. Without some kind of choice, we could not choose to love. And so God gave us a choice because he wanted us to have a love relationship with him. But he influences all through his creation, through the cross, through the Word, through the Holy Spirit. He's drawing us to himself, but many still choose to follow their own way, to follow their own sinfulness and the sinfulness of the world. And so the question for us is this, who will we choose? Or what will we choose? And it's not based on our circumstances. Because whether we win the lottery or we struggle with leukemia, we still have to make that choice. Who or what will we follow? that we can openly praise God in a situation like this, or we must be in a dark, secret place to worship God, we still have to ask the question, who or what will we choose? Yes, there are times when it seems like God is sleeping, but He still knows us, and He knows our hearts. He is still at work. No matter what we face, can we say, with the psalmist, our heart has not turned back. I will follow Him. Our steps have not deviated from Your way, O Lord. See, the call of God on our lives is not one of convenience. It's one of commitment. A word not understood very well in our culture today. Because commitment is not based on circumstances or feelings. This is the call Jesus has made to us. We are called to follow Jesus no matter what we face in this world. Jesus challenged His disciples and us by saying in Matthew chapter 16, verses 24 and 25, if anyone wishes to come after Me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow Me. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for My sake will find it. It's not a call of convenience. It's not a call of ease and pleasure and comfort. It is a call of radical commitment to Jesus Christ, no matter the circumstances of our lives, no matter what we face. I like what commentator Peter Craigie writes when he says, Psalm 44, with its concluding prayer, points in the same direction as the book of Job. Namely, that there is an immense mystery in God and His ways, but one must continue to trust and to pray. Trust and pray. And so we have to ask the question of ourselves, are we willing to trust? Are we willing to pray? Are we willing to follow Christ no matter what the circumstances of our life? Whatever we face in this life, we must remember what God has done in the past. Whatever we face in this life, we must remain faithful to God in the future. And then third, whatever we face in this life, we must remember God will redeem us in the future. Whatever happens to us in the future, as a nation, as individuals, we can trust that God's at work. And whatever we face, He is going to bring us into His presence if we have put our faith in Jesus Christ. He will redeem us. Now, as a nation, Israel didn't know what God had in store for them. They didn't know. We know in their history that eventually God allowed the northern kingdom to basically be decimated in 722 B.C. Anyways, they were no more. The southern kingdom, mostly the tribe of Judah, was taken into the captivity by the Babylonians in 586 B.C. They were there for another 70 years and more. Though the nation was restored from their captivity, in 516 B.C., the temple was rebuilt. Basically, the nation floundered in many ways for many, many hundreds of years. Once again, the temple was destroyed in 70 A.D., Herod's temple. But again, the Jewish people were just kind of out there for hundreds of years. It was not until the Balfour Declaration in 1917 and then the establishment of the State of Israel in 1948 and the Six-Day War of 1967 that Israel again gained a new sense of their identity as a nation. Who would have known it would have taken so long? But all of this is part of the purpose and plan of God, even the fulfillment of scriptures like like Jeremiah 29:10, Isaiah 43:5-6, and Zechariah 8:7-8, that God's the plan for the nation of Israel. But think about it. When God was silent in that period after they came back from Babylon, around 400 BC, from that time, we have nothing in Scripture for quite some time. It seemed the days of Israel that God had abandoned them. And yet, what happened? What was God up to? He still had a plan. When it seemed that he was silent and abandoned by many, he fulfilled many of his plans and prophecies concerning the Messiah Jesus. He was still at work. The babe was born in Bethlehem, according to Micah chapter 5, verse 2. The light of the Gentiles came out of Nazareth, according to Isaiah 11. Jesus proclaimed liberty to the captives, according to Isaiah 61. The suffering servant came on the scene, according to Isaiah 53. And on the third day, Jesus rose from the belly of death, and Jonah had come forth from the belly of the whale. See, God was still at work, and in fact, he was answering the psalmist's prayer from Psalm 44, verse 26, when the psalmist prayed, Lord, we need your help. But God answered that prayer in sending Jesus to redeem. That we are unworthy as a nation and as individuals. Because of the promise of Scripture, we know today that if we put our trust and faith in Jesus Christ as our Savior, we will be redeemed. God will buy us back from death and the penalty of sin. And through Christ's shed blood on the cross, our sins will be washed if we put our faith in Him. It is the loving kindness and grace of God which is sufficient for us, and therefore we have hope, the hope of eternal life through Jesus Christ. The psalmist says in Psalm 130, verses 7 and 8, O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is loving kindness, and with Him is abundant redemption, and He will redeem Israel from all His iniquities. Paul speaks of this fulfillment in Galatians 4, 4 and 5, but when the fullness of the time came, God sent forth His Son, born of a woman, born under the law, so that He might redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. I don't know if God's withdrawn His hand from the nation. I don't know that specifically. Sometimes it may feel like it. But I do know this, that whatever God has in store for our nation, I don't put my faith in the nation. I don't put my faith in the government. I put my faith in Jesus Christ. And whatever I or our nation has to go through, I know that my hope is in Him. For I know that me, my Redeemer, lives, and at the last He will take His stand on the earth. I know that from in my flesh and my skin will be destroyed, but on that last day, I will know that my Redeemer lives. How about you? Where is your hope? Are you willing to say, I don't know what my life's going to be like the rest of the days the Lord gives me? I don't know what's going to happen in this nation. I don't know what we're going to have to face as Christians. But I want my brothers and sisters to know this morning that whatever we have to face, I'm going to follow Jesus. I'm going to put my trust in Him. I'm going to seek to deny myself, take up my cross, and follow Him. Even if I have to literally lose my life, because I know in Jesus Christ, are so thankful for the assurance we have this morning that our life is in you if we put our faith in Christ. And so once again, we want to say this morning that we choose Jesus. I want to invite everyone who'd like to say that to the Lord this morning, whether for the first time, if you want to receive Jesus Christ as your Savior, or you've been a Christian for 30 years, but you just want to confirm before the Lord this morning, Jesus, I want to follow you, and I'm going to follow you no matter what. If you'd like to do that this morning, I just want to invite you before the throne of God to raise up your hand and say, Lord, I choose to follow you no matter what. You'd like to do that this morning, just say, Lord, I'm going to follow you no matter what. Lord, help us, enable us. Of ourselves, we are too weak. Of ourselves, we are too of the flesh. But Lord, by your Spirit and grace, we will follow you. Enable us to do that, Lord. Jesus, we pray for our nation. Bring reconciliation. Bring wisdom. Bring encouragement. Help your church to stand in the truth. Help us to speak the truth in love. And help us to live for you as we pray in Jesus' name.